Welcome. I'm Sebastian Mahfoud, and you're listening to WCAT Radio, the on-air wing of En Route Books and Media, bringing you the dulcet sounds of Catholic wisdom.
Welcome to the Armor of Faith, a show where we hope to bring our listeners closer to the Word of God and the blessings we receive through living in the fullness of the Catholic faith. My name is Doug, and I'll be your host today as we discuss the blessings of the Church Christ built upon Peter. And I'm also joined today by my panel, which includes my lovely wife, Sharon, as well as Helen Hawkins. And Helen is a lay Dominican and has a love for music ministry. The Dominicans, I should mention, are also known as the Order of Preachers, so that fits really well with a radio show format. Sharon is still our token cradle Catholic, and as everybody knows by now, I'm simply here to ask questions because, well, questions open the doors to answers. So to answer those questions is why we have our panelists. So welcome to our panelists as well as to our listeners. We're also joined today with a special guest panelist, which is Lenita Cox. And Lenita has a master's degree in internal personal communication and is currently working on her doctorate in Christian counseling. She has been on staff at Her Choice Birmingham Women's Center as a client advocate for 3 years and provides clients with life-affirming education and counseling. You can learn more about Her Choice Birmingham Women's Center at herchoicebirmingham.org. So, Lenita, welcome to the show today.
Thank you very much. I'm glad to be here.
Let us open with a prayer. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Heavenly Father, we lift up our hearts and thanks and praise for this opportunity to open and share your holy word this day. We pray that you are with us and all our listeners as we share with one another the blessings of faith. We pray you will grant us wisdom and understanding as we seek to learn your holy truth. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we pray, amen. So last time during our show concerning post-abortion ministry, we mentioned that with all the political rage concerning abortion, we must remember the issue is not politics, but lives. As Father Frank Pavone of Priest for Life points out, abortion has many victims beyond the child. As we consider the spectrum of life, we mention that we must also consider the lives left behind after abortion. Our compassion and empathy must consider these lives as well. It is not ours to assume culpability or blame a mother who has endured an abortion, for we do not know by what factors decisions were made, whether they were forced, coerced, misinformed, or simply those involved in the decision did not understand the ramifications. Pro-abortion activists will cite studies which indicate women feel no trauma or even a sense of relief after an abortion. But as Father Pavone points out, 7 to 10 years down the road, what was once relief can transform into suffering. We must also remember that post-abortive mothers are not the only ones impacted. For while the political shouting matches rage, we often forget fathers and extended family members as well. Each story is different. We often do not see the triggers of grief, depression, anxiety, or stress coming, but when they hit, they can be quite painful and disruptive to our lives. To be pro-life, we must tend to the needs of the spectrum of life, which includes those who remain after a life is lost. Today, though, we want to talk on a more positive note and discuss the counseling available through pregnancy resource centers for those who are about to take on the challenge of parenthood. Especially with an unplanned pregnancy, there are many concerns about what it means to become a parent. And there can be many complicating factors, such as demands of job or school, financial issues, childcare, and, of course, the emotional uncertainty of how to be a good parent. So as a young woman or couple work to navigate through all the uncertainties, there are pre-counseling services available through pregnancy resource centers that can help prepare parents to face and address the coming challenges. Let me ask our guests, what is the nature of parental support counseling and who is eligible to receive it? Lenita?
At our center, we encourage women to come in as soon as they find out that they're pregnant. The earlier they come into our center, the more we can help them. So we provide services such as helping them to file for Medicaid. We give them doctor referrals so that they know what doctors in our area do accept Medicaid. We explain the process of how to get those appointments all set up. We also talk with them about their living arrangements to make sure that they are in a safe environment, and if they need shelter outside of, you know, what they have now, that we can work with them to get them into perhaps a maternity home or even sometimes just a shelter until we can find a more permanent situation for them. So we also, we have lots of other, you know, I can go on and on for days on the things that we do for these women, but we provide Earn While You Learn programs so that they can earn money to purchase the things that they need for their children, such as cribs and car seats and clothes and diapers and wipes in that area. So we provide a lot.
So as you mentioned shelters, are there shelters in your area that are specific to mothers in need?
Yes, we have some that are specific to mothers in need. There are some that are specific, age-specific, you know, that will take women like, for instance, between the ages of 19 and 26. And some of those shelters, not necessarily being maternity homes, but they do accept women who are pregnant or who have children already. And so we try to get them into, you know, a situation where they're safe and where, like, they can get the needs met that they have, whether that be education with parenting or, you know, job readiness, financial stability so that they can learn how to manage their finances. There's lots of programs out there available. We are limited as far as maternity homes in our area. The closest one to us is roughly about 3 hours away. And so maternity homes are few and far between, but we do have some shelters that will take in women with children.
Okay. So one of the things, of course, as we look at the individual, everyone's story is different. So when you engage someone that's coming in and asking for assistance, is there just one standard program that you present to them, or do you consider their unique situations and kind of tailor assistance to their needs?
We consider their unique situations because everyone's story is different. Everyone has different needs. And we really, in our initial consultation with that client, whenever they initially come in, we try to, you know, assess their needs, get them to share with us what their background is, what their greatest needs are, and we try to implement a program that will help them to achieve the goals that they have as well as meet the needs for them and their children. You know, sometimes we have situations where the women have stable housing but need childcare. And so we assess, you know, we have different programs that we assist them with so that they can get childcare assistance. We also have women who come in who are needing, you know, like financial help. Maybe their rent is past due or their utility bill is past due, and we have resources where we can help them with that as well.
And, of course, you know, one of the things that I've talked with a variety of folks when they talk about women trying to navigate particularly an unplanned pregnancy, one of the major concerns is finances. What resources are available to them?
Well, our center specifically, we are very, very blessed with a great donor base, and we are financed completely by donors. We have no government assistance in our program, but we do an Earn While You Learn program with our women that is basically a parenting class. And with that parenting class, they will learn all kinds of things about taking care of their children and their finances and how to navigate relationships and sexual integrity. And we cover a lot of different things in that class. So every time a woman would come to one of our classes, they would get what we call mommy money. And we would bank that mommy money until a month before their due date, and then they're allowed to shop at our center. So, for instance, a woman at our center can get a brand new crib. That is a usually we try to get a convertible crib that comes with a mattress and a sheet, and that crib is going to cost them roughly $18 of mommy money. And so a car seat at our center, it's brand new, is usually about $8. So, you know, we try to meet their needs with tangible items that are going to be useful for them, as well as, you know, other community programs that may offer the, like, the utility support and those kind of things.
Mm-hmm. Do you find it... Oh, excuse me.
Go ahead, Ellen.
Do you find it easier to deal with these problems without government help at all? Is there less restrictions on what you can do?
Yes. We find that it's much easier to deal with things in-house as opposed to trying to jump through the hoops and doing the paperwork that's required for government assistance. Now, you know, most of our clients need Medicaid, you know, because they have to be able to have that coverage for their prenatal care, and that's necessary, you know, so we make sure that they can navigate those waters and point them in the right directions. But outside of that, we try to do the majority of our things, 100% of everything that we do in our center is all donor-based, so non-government assistance.
Okay.
And you mentioned Medicaid. So do you provide assistance to help them understand how to navigate the application process?
Yes, we help them navigate the application process. We kind of talk them through that. There's also standalone Medicaid offices in our area that will help them navigate those waters as well. We also explain to them with the Medicaid in our state, there is an office at the hospital that they choose to deliver their baby at. We've got several, so they have a choice of hospitals, but they need to get in touch with a steps ahead coordinator, and that steps ahead coordinator at the hospital will actually assign them to a doctor and help them to get their first prenatal care set up. And we at our center really try diligently to follow our clients throughout their pregnancy by calling them on a regular basis and making sure that they're getting to their appointments, making sure that they're not in need of something, you know, that so that they're not coming up to the due date and then all of a sudden there's a need that we didn't know about.
So it sounds like you establish a relationship as the mother is progressing towards her due date. And in that relationship, is it also a bit of a mentorship type program?
Yes, we try to really come alongside these women and give them good solid advice, good Christian advice. You know, we want them to understand what their choices in the future will. You know, how if they make better choices in the future, then their futures can be brighter and better. And so we want to teach them and train them as they go. And you can't do that if you don't establish a relationship. You know, as the old saying goes, no one cares how much you know until you know, till they know how much you care. So.
Yeah. Yes, that's a good point. And then some centers have, for example, parental support groups. In other words, where they bring mothers and sometimes even and fathers in as well, depending upon the relationship between the mother and the father, into works or workshop type settings, to where they kind of end up establishing their own support and mutual relationships. Do you have anything similar to that?
We do. We actually we encourage dads as much as they can, moms, or you know a someone who can be a support system to our moms, to attend the Earn While You Learn classes with them at our center whenever they have progressed through the program and they've given birth to their baby, we actually have a group outside of our center that is a church group that has started, that this church has come alongside us and created a support program for these women outside of our center. And so they are mentored not just, you know, during their pregnancy, but also after their pregnancy. And they're encouraged to bring their children. And, you know, there's women and men there who will help them to learn how to be mom and dad and to come alongside them and mentor them more than just, you know, that day-to-day, more than just what we do day-to-day, but long-term.
Okay. One thing that I've noted in talking with various people is that sometimes not everyone who can benefit from this counseling receives it. What are some of the obstacles that keep someone from talking with you and opening the door to be able to receive the services you offer?
Access to transportation is a big issue in our area. And then time constraints as far as being able to attend daytime classes is an issue in our area. And then, you know, sometimes it's just pure and simple that they just don't have a desire, and we have to foster that desire and help them to understand that, you know, if you put in some effort, we're going to meet you halfway. And sometimes it takes a little more encouragement to get someone to participate. Maybe they're a little shy or they're a little bit, you know, embarrassed about their situation. And so they just don't want to just expose themselves. And so, you know, sometimes it's difficult to overcome those. We do have a program at our center that's called Embrace Grace. And that is a program that is set up for women who are in an unplanned pregnancy, whether they're married or unmarried. And they can come into this program. It's a Bible study. And it helps these women to accept who they are in Christ and to learn to embrace being the daughter of a king and treating themselves, their bodies, and their children like the daughter of a king. And so it's really a great program that helps encourage more participation as well. We are blessed in our area that we do have a program that gives free ride services for doctor's appointments, and they have actually approved a free ride service for our center for our Earn While You Learn program. And so that really makes it nice that we can provide some transportation. You know, if they don't have it, then we can provide it so that they can get there through the Kid One program.
Do you have programs for fathers, or is there any demand for that?
We do not have specific programs for the men in our program, in our center. There are other centers in our area that do have male mentors, but we have a few men who come in and will do that unofficially. If men need counseling or if they want someone to mentor them. In our experience, that's less wanted than the other programs that we offer.
But there are programs in the area.
Yes, there are programs in the area, and we do have a couple men who would gladly step up and mentor these men if they so desired. But the men are also included in our Earn While You Learn program, and we specifically touch things that are important to the fathers as well as the mothers.
Okay.
So, Lenita, one of the things that you mentioned there is sometimes there's a concern of embarrassment, and usually that's, you know, that's also a result of a fear of judgmentalism. How do you go about overcoming that and being able to establish a positive relationship?
We try to meet these women where they are. We don't sugarcoat things. I'm not saying that we don't confront them with things that are not healthy in their life, because we do. but we try to confront those things with as much love and support. And, you know, and we oftentimes will share our own stories, you know, and that just to kind of give them an understanding that, you know, we have paths of our own. And, you know, none of us have walked this earth without making mistakes and without making poor judgment calls. And so we try to help them to understand that it's not about where you came from, it's where you're going.
So as a mother comes in and comes to talk to you, I'm sure you kind of have a spectrum, if you will, in terms of people that are they're just looking for information, looking for support. But do you experience sometimes where women come in and appear very defensive and not even sure that they really want to have a conversation with you? Do you experience that very often?
Yes. Our center, we're unique in our center in that we see a good portion of abortion-minded clients. And whenever we have some of those abortion-minded clients who do choose to carry their children, sometimes that's a little more of an obstacle to get over because they already feel like they're battling an uphill battle. And so getting them to really open up and share and to establish that relationship is not easy. But, you know, we have the mindset of at our center that love wins. And so we try to love these women through it.
I like that. I like that slogan, love wins. Because that's, in a lot of cases, that's one thing that we really have to remember is that when someone's life has been changed, because that's exactly what ends up happening when a new life comes into it, it's been changed, and there's a lot of uncertainties. And there's also a lot of societal misinformation out there and even disinformation that they're having to deal with and sort through and navigate. And so at that particular moment, that's when love is most important for that person. That's really the one most powerful thing that will help them navigate all the unknowns that they are perhaps feeling overwhelmed with in the moment. But when someone comes in defensive, it can also be rather difficult to help them see that you're there to offer compassion and empathy and to listen with confidentiality and to help them walk this walk, but to help them in a loving manner.
Yes. It's, you know, I sat with a couple just today, and the guy said to me, "You have no idea what our neighborhood is like. You have no idea what our lives are like." And I said, "That's very true. I have no idea. I have never walked in your shoes, but I want you to know that I am here to support you, and I will do everything I can to help you to navigate this situation in a happy and healthy way." And that's just what you have to do. You have to just meet them where they're at.
Yes. So one of the criticisms of pregnancy resource centers that it is all about religion and imposing religion on those who are emotionally vulnerable. And in more than one pro-abortion article that I've read, I observed reference to the narrative that women enter a pregnancy resource center for help and all they get handed is the Bible. So what role does religion play in the counseling process? And what if someone in need does not have a religion or does not have the same religious preference as an organization that's providing assistance? How do you approach that?
So in our center, we do ask the women on their initial intake sheet, we do ask them if they have any spiritual beliefs. We ask them if they're connected to a church of any kind. We do not specifically present the gospel to them. We just ask them what their beliefs are. and we want to know where they're coming from. And if they come to us and they say, well, I have no spiritual beliefs, I don't believe in God, then our comment usually to them is, well, God believes in you. And so we're going to meet your needs, and we're going to show you that God believes in you. And that's kind of where we leave it. And then we establish a relationship by helping them with their physical needs. And then, you know, as time goes on, we have more of an opportunity to show Christ to them just in the way that we act without even having to hand them a Bible. You know, we put hands and feet to Jesus, and we have found that actions speak louder than words a lot of times anyway. And, you know, we try not to demean anyone by their beliefs, or if we need to approach a subject in a scientific manner, then we can approach it in the scientific manner and usually, you know, make some headway with showing them that we care, even though we have different beliefs. You know, they don't have to believe exactly the way I do, but I'm going to show them through my actions how much God loves me, and in some small way how much I can portray that love to them.
Yeah. And as you mentioned that, so when people come in and you try to find information about them, you know, one of the things that I've seen from NARAL and then other public, you know, mainstream publications is they talk about that particular fact. So we try to find out information about the person. So like you say, we can get to know them. We can get to know their needs. And one of the questions that is typically asked is, you know, do you have a particular faith, or do you go to a particular church or something along those lines? And what's unfair about the way they represent it is they present it as like it's something like we're trying to impose the faith upon them, as opposed to finding out do they have a particular faith. And the reason why I think it's important that we understand if someone does or does not have a particular faith is because it does influence how you relate to them, so that you aren't in a position that, well, I'm trying to impose faith, because as you mentioned, we put hands and feet on Jesus. We do more preaching simply by doing than we do mm-hmm. by pulling someone in and quoting scripture or things of that nature. So my understanding is, as I've interviewed folks from a variety of different pregnancy centers, is the intent is not to impose a faith on someone, but sometimes faith is a conduit for someone that is struggling if they have a particular faith, and it enables the conversation, or they may find a certain comfort in knowing the forgiveness that is there, but also the love to which we are called. And that's why we as pro-life people, or people that subscribe to pro-life, and particularly if we have a faith-based background, we're wanting to reach out in love, whereas we get portrayed in the media as if we are somehow religious zealots that are trying to impose a faith on a person that's in a hapless circumstance.
Right. We try not to approach anyone by condemning, you know, or saying that you have to believe exactly the way I believe. We want to meet them where they're at and just help them walk, you know, closer to where they need to be.
Well, I've noticed that it is important to know where somebody is coming from, whether or not they believe what religion they are, or even if they're atheists or agnostics. There's a language that I find that I will use if I'm talking to a Christian. There are expressions I use, expressions they use, that we understand the same. Whereas if you would use that same expression with somebody who does not believe, they would either find it that they just don't understand it in the same way. So I think it is very important that we know, or that you know, what the status is, so you know what to say or what not to say.
Yes, it is very, very important that we know, and that's why we ask, because, you know, that does shape who we are, and, you know, it gives us a frame of reference to reach out to them. We have found in our center that a good number of them, I'm guessing somewhere around 80%, do profess some form of faith, and, you know, sometimes it's just simply asking them, how does what's going on in your life line up with what you believe about God? And then, you know, taking them from there. So
that makes sense. If somebody has a concept of God as being a cruel and that's been their experience or what they mm-hmm. believe, you can then work with them to teach them that is not who God is.
Exactly.
Have you, I assume I know the answer to this, but have you ever turned anyone away because of the faith that they express or their lack of faith?
Never.
And I think that's an important point to bring out as well, because, again, the media often tries to portray us as faith zealots, as opposed to people that are concerned and have a desire to enable life and to help those that are navigating those challenges because of a new life that is now entered into their thought processes, their decision making, and all these types of things. Another criticism of those who believe in the sanctity of life is that we're really just pro-birth, that we really do not care about the family after birth. What will someone seeking parental support counseling experience during the process, and does support end with the birth of the child?
No. Now, I will say that our support at our center is a little more limited as once they have had their children. But we do still maintain contact with our clients even after they've had their children. Oftentimes, clients will call us if they're in need of diapers or formula or, you know, clothes, something like that. They'll call us up and say, hey, I'm in need. You know, I had a client just yesterday who was in that situation. She was in need of formula and had no way of getting formula for her baby. And so we provided that formula for her. We also have many of our clients who will come back to us and bring their children in and say, look, I want you to see. And, you know, we try to maintain that relationship with them. And that is where the churches in our area have really come into play in stepping up and saying, let us help you to mentor these people, you know, and getting them connected. We have the Church of the Reconciler in Fairfield area has a program that's called Pathway. And these couples can come into this program and this church just comes alongside them and loves them and supports them and gives them, you know, a connection outside of our building. You know, I think it's important to not just keep it inside our building. We need to have that outside support where people are going to come in and really support them in a day-to-day, you know, situation. We also made a connection with a woman who really wasn't our client. We had not seen her early in her pregnancy. She called us. She was living under a bridge, and she was six, seven months pregnant and had nowhere to go. And we connected her with a maternity home, and that maternity home in Alberta, Alabama, helped this woman, and she is now actually being reconciled with not just the baby that she gave birth with, but other children that she had lost custody of. and she's now in a stable home, and she has a stable job, and she has a car. And, you know, she's succeeding because she had support that lasted longer than her pregnancy. And, you know, that's our goal, is to make connections, and to, if we can't do it specifically, we try to find somebody who can.
You know, kind of one of the things, just kind of drawing an analogy here, again, criticisms that get directed against the Pregnancy Resource Centers is that, well, you're not doing everything in-house. But the way I kind of view a Pregnancy Resource Center is almost like the hub of a wagon wheel. In other words, not all the problem solving is done at the Pregnancy Resource Center, but they're the hub where they can help identify those that can help solve problems.
Right.
Whether it's financial need or medical issues, like you say, you might have a stock of baby items in there, but you also might have information of other agencies that may be able to provide similar assistance.
Right.
And the like.
Do
you have any difference between prenatal and postnatal counseling?
There is a little bit of difference between the prenatal and the postnatal, just because, you know, with the prenatal, you really focus on the mom's health and really how she's caring for herself as she's pregnant. With women who come in after their pregnancy, we really talk to them about abstinence, and we talk to them about taking care of their bodies, understanding how their bodies work. We have a program, actually, that is set up. It's FEM, and it's an acronym for Fertility Education and Medical Management. And it's a program that helps women to actually learn about their bodies so that whenever they're no longer pregnant, they can, you know, understand how their bodies work. And it will help them to, one, avoid birth control, and teaches them the value of their body, and teaches them to abstain, and to understand how their body functions. And so, you know, we try to provide not just, you know, information about how they're going to take care of their bodies while they're pregnant, but also how they take care of their bodies once they're not pregnant anymore. And we do that as well with relationships. Trying to get them to understand the value of a permanent relationship, you know, and teaching them that, you know, marriage is key, which unfortunately is something that seems to be a difficult message to get across, because so many of our young people have such a bad view of marriage. And we really try to instill in them that marriage is important.
And, of course, you know, one of the things that as we look that you've established a relationship with these mothers and sometimes with the fathers as well, and I know every story is different, but on average, how long does this a relationship with them last from the time they come in and the time that they kind of become either self-sufficient or are primarily working with another agency?
Usually for our center, usually about a year, they're going to be in contact with us. And then, you know, depending on whether they have, you know, future pregnancies, they will come back to us. We also provide other types of counseling, whether it be, you know, relationship counseling, post-abortion counseling, different things like that, that bring the women back to us as well. As far as, you know, really our center is a little limited because we do have a scope. You know, our focus and our mission in our center is to help women who are in a pregnancy. So that does limit us a little bit, but we try really hard, like you mentioned before, being that center spoke that sends them out to, you know, that center hub that sends them out to the spokes that helps them to find other resources as well. So they know our doors are always open no matter what.
Okay. So one thing that we might hope, and Helen kind of asked about this a little bit earlier, is that both father and mother will travel this journey together. And they might be able to come and attend parental support counseling together. But, of course, there's any number of factors that may prevent that. So what if both parents do not want or are unable to take advantage of the counseling?
We still offer, with our program, with our Earn While You Learn program, we offer if they're both working, say, you know, so if the husband and or the man and the woman, whether they be husband and wife or not, if they're employed and they can't come to the classes that we offer during the daytime, then we offer them homework, and they can do that homework at home and then turn it into us, and they still get to participate in the Earn While You Learn program doing it that way. We try to connect them with other resource centers that maybe do classes at night. You know, we're limited because if they're not willing to meet us halfway, then we can't force something on them, you know. But we try to meet them and meet their needs, their time constraints, as well as their, you know, their physical limitations as best that we can.
So. You mentioned earlier that there's not as much demand for counseling for fathers. As far as your experience, what are some of the typical reasons why fathers don't want to come in for the counseling?
Well, oftentimes if they're working, they don't feel like that they can, you know, take that time. And sadly, with the demographic that we're dealing with, there's just not a lot of fathers who really want to participate. They don't see their role as being that important. And unfortunately, they're getting the message that whether this woman decides to parent or not is none of their business. And so they just choose not to be there. And you know, it's as if someone else has taken their role on because they're not needed for support because, you know, there's government services that pick up where they left off. And so it just limits their desire to participate.
From the feedback that you've received, do you think that there's also sometimes a role in the way fathers are either portrayed in our society or the example that they may have received from their own fathers?
Yes. You know, it's very often that they don't have a role model, a male role model in their life. You know, they were raised by their mother or their aunt or you know, a household of women, and men were just not present. And so there is some lack of understanding what their role really is. And, you know, we really encourage men, and any time that a father comes in, I make it a point to thank them for coming and reiterating to them how important it is for them to have the role of father in this baby's life. And, you know, that they become the protector and the leader of their homes. As you know, it's just necessary for them to be there. So.
Do you sometimes think they also fear judgmentalism? That they're going to be, everybody's going to be looking at them that, well, you're the real cause of the problem?
Yes, yes, I think they do. I think, you know, and society has just told them that they're not needed. And they've begun to believe it. And, you know, it's we really try to instill in them how important it is for them to be a major role. You know, and we try to get them to understand, so you know, if you didn't have a father in your life, you know what you've missed. And so let's help you to be to your child and provide for your child what you didn't have. You know, and that's really where we try to come at it, you know, is to just bolster their role and the importance of their role.
Yeah, because I think that's that's really an important thing that our society appears to be losing touch with, is the importance of the partnership in parenting, that mm-hmm. it's not just one person's role in parenting, in that. And, of course, then that's why we call people to marriage, is that marriage is an example or a bonding of that partnership. But truly, to raise children effectively, it requires both parents. It's now, that's not to say that to diminish anyone that is in a single-parent relationship. There's a variety of reasons why you may end up with there, and you have to do the best that you can in that. But when you do have two people coming together, that partnership makes work for both of them easier.
Right. Well, you know, it's very difficult for one person to be everything to someone else. You know, yeah. it's an impossible task to be everything to someone else, you know, and that's the importance of there being a mother and a father. That's the importance of having aunts and uncles. That's the importance of having grandparents that participate. You know, it's all about that lineage and that legacy that you're creating whenever you both participate.
Well, it seems to me, just come to my thoughts, that the it's almost a two-edged sword. People do need the governmental help, and I'm not going to diminish that at all, but it also creates its own problems because people are not really being able taught how to take care of themselves or how to establish these relationships, because it's almost easier not to.
Right. I mean, it is very, very necessary for people to have the government help that is out there.
Oh, yeah.
Because,
oh, yeah.
I mean, it's really, really hard to manage to survive on a two-income household. And if
right.
it's a one-income
no.
household, that makes it even worse. But
yeah, no,
we
but
definitely
don't misunderstand
need...
me on that at all, because I'm not criticizing. But it also, there needs to be some way, some program or a program such as yours that can help young men come to an understanding about
right.
this.
Right. Well, and they just need to find value in their role. And unfortunately, we've taken away their value.
Yeah.
Because,
yeah.
you know, it's been such a message of women can do it all. And we can't do it all. We need fathers. We need them to be there for the mother, to be there for the child. We need that role to be filled.
And they need that role as well.
Yes.
For their own happiness.
Mm-hmm. Because yeah. it gives them value and worth.
Yep.
Yeah.
So another criticism of pregnancy resource centers is that they are staffed with untrained personnel. So what type of training and experience are required for those who are engaged in parental support counseling?
So at our center, we have training that reaches the gamut. I mean, we've got on staff right now at our center. We have two nurses that are on staff that also do sonograms for us. We have, I have done, you know, extensive research in communication, interpersonal communication in the respect that, you know, how to communicate in a relationship. I have a master's degree. It's not required that you have that kind of training, because we do also in-house training, which means that anyone that comes into our center, it goes through a significant training process. we actually work with Heartbeat, and Heartbeat has a system set up. And, you know, we don't reinvent the wheel. We use their program so that we can train our staff so that they're well-informed and they know how to handle a situation. We don't put someone in a room that has not been fully trained. They will sit in on counseling sessions. They will observe phone calls. They, you know, we have an extensive training process that we go through in-house as well. So.
And I do know that because of the nature of pregnancy resource centers, that they do vary in terms of who their sponsors are. But as you brought up, Heartbeat International, that there are not necessarily a dedicated network, but it's still a networking that centers can sign into to be able to share knowledge amongst one another, to be able to establish some forms of standards. Some centers have licensed counselors on staff. Others, the counselor receives the training based upon the type of service that's being offered through the counseling, whether it's a crisis-type counseling or whether it's counseling along the lines of helping someone navigate financial assistance or navigate healthcare or you know, whatever the particular challenge is. So the training education, it may sometimes be scoped or focused in that particular direction.
Right. So, as I said, we have nurses on staff. We have a social worker that volunteers with us. We have a good variety of educated women that come in and come alongside us and work with our counselors and with our clients. And you know, and it's not, we also are moms, and so mm-hmm. we've walked that road as mothers. We have women who are not mothers that have walked that road of not being a parent, and you know, so they can give some insight into those areas as well. I mean, we really try to have a variety of resources available.
Yes. So for the benefit of our listeners who desire counseling or may have a friend or loved one who may be in need, you know, one of the challenges is being able to find what centers may be in your area, your location. So I'd like to give a few links here that people can use. One is CareNet, and you can find them online at www.care-net.org/find-a-pregnancy-center. So that's kind of a long one there, but so it would be www.care-net.org/find-a-pregnancy-center. Another one that's available is OptionLine at optionline.org/center-locator. And then, as Lenita mentioned, Heartbeat International, they can be found at www.heartbeatinternational.org. And if you go to heartbeatinternational.org/worldwide-directory, they also have an easy tool in there where you can enter your location and find services that are in your area. And, of course, one thing we like to do on this show is to encourage our listeners to support the culture of life. But as we discussed during previous episodes in this series, there is a broad spectrum to the support of life from conception to natural death. So if someone has a interest in supporting or assisting parental support ministry, where might they seek more information about the different options for helping?
We have a website that is herchoicebirmingham.org, and that also gives some information about what we do there and what services we offer. And we do have a donation line there as well. You know, really calling your local pregnancy center, ask them what their needs are. You know, do they need diapers? It's not just about monetary things. Do they need somebody to come in and sort the clothing that they have? You know, can you participate physically, can you participate monetarily? You know, it's there's lots of ways to do that. Prayer is huge. We have had great benefit by having just groups of people to come into our center and just pray. They find a place in the back of the building, and they just sit and pray for us, and that helps. You know, participating in a pregnancy center is not just a monetary thing. It's you don't have to go there. Pray for them. You know, get in touch with your local center and find out what their needs are.
Absolutely. And also you can use some of those same links that I just mentioned to find out or find pregnancy centers in your area, as well as checking with your parish or church ministry coordinators. They often know who is engaged in that type of ministry. And as you mentioned, it's not just money. And also it's not always direct contact with people. Sometimes they need people to do some of the work in the, you know, behind the scenes in the background, just something, as you mentioned there, just as simple as sorting donations and being able to place things on the shelves and the like. So, Lenita, thank you. I really appreciate your expertise today from the perspective of a real-life pregnancy center or your experience there. Some quotes I'd like to share with our listeners today. The first one comes from St. John Paul II, who said, "You are called to stand up for life, to respect and defend the mystery of life always and everywhere, including the lives of unborn babies, giving real help and encouragement to mothers in difficult situations. You are called to work and pray against abortion." St. Teresa of Calcutta said, "The special power of loving that belongs to a woman is seen most clearly when she becomes a mother. Motherhood is the gift of God to women, yet we can destroy this gift of motherhood, especially by the evil of abortion." So some final thoughts. As we discussed earlier, one of the criticisms directed at those who believe in the sanctity of life is that we are not really pro-life, we are just pro-birth. We simply want the child to be born, then we wash our hands of the situation. And that would be sad if it were true, but as we've discussed, there is help and assistance for parents beyond the day of birth. This help is available in a variety of ways, but mothers and fathers are often unaware of the support available to them. And perhaps one of the most important services which pregnancy resource centers provide is information through which parents can navigate the road from pregnancy to raising a child. We often refer to children as bundles of joy, but we also know they can be bundles of challenges as well. And I know this as a result of my own experiences of being both a child and a parent. I was quite disruptive as a child, and I had a lot to learn as a parent. So all the challenges ahead can be quite overwhelming, and the stress can impact our emotions and the quality of our decision-making. Pregnancy counselors and parental support counselors can help parents to navigate the stress and emotions of the unknowns before them, as well as enable them to take on the challenging role of parent. It goes without saying that for any parent, there will be times of hard work, there will be times of great stress, but there will also be times of great joy and love. So let us all remember in our prayers the child, the parents, the extended family, as well as those who stand ready to help parents to raise and help prepare the future of our society. Well, our time has come to an end, and we hope you'll be able to join us next week as we discuss a different segment of the spectrum of life, which is the push for physician-assisted suicide. We hope you'll be able to join us as we discuss the issues, the potential for abuse, and what we can do to stop the advance of the promotion of death solutions. Let us conclude with a prayer. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to open and discuss your holy word. We pray that as we go our separate ways, you will continue to walk with us and help us to see how we may put on the armor of truth, righteousness, peace, faith, salvation, and the word of the gospel, not only for the benefit of our lives, but also the lives of all who cross our path. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Thank you all, and God bless.
We hope you enjoyed the program and will join us back for another show on WCAT Radio. This is Sebastian Mahfood. Good day.